Praise the Lord, saints. Hallelujah. We are here at Kingdom Faith Ministries tonight, and it's a blessing to be in the land of the living.
Yes.
Saints of God and you who are tuned in, we thank God for you. Thank God for my brother in the gospel, Bishop Larry Donald of Greater Trinity. We thank God for him tonight. We've been dealing with obedience, haven't we?
Yes.
But we talked about being in Christ, and everything has been put under the feet of Christ, and we've been put in him. Mm-hmm. We talked about that Ephesians 1:16, and we talked about how the church in Christ, being in him, and all principalities and all this stuff has been put under the feet of Christ. So we've been placed in him. But we want to talk about tonight, we said we were going to talk about the armor of God. Be strong in the Lord. Now, this is what we're going to be dealing with tonight. Why do the armor of God work for some and not for others? Why does the word of God produces protection for some and not for others? And I think if we really, really sit down and think, I think we'll run it down to the ones who are obeying God have a track record of knowing God's word works. In the day of time, in the day of testing, in the time of battle, Jesus, we talked about Jesus, went into the wilderness and he only used the word of God. He didn't say, I bind you, Satan. He said, it is written.
Right.
Adam had the same opportunity to use what God had spoke to him. And saints of God, we have the same opportunity to say it is written.
Yes.
But we also got to live by. Jesus said man should not live by physical bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
Amen.
So Jesus knew the word would get him out of this situation. But saints, if you're going to walk above and not beneath, you got to know that this word, Jesus tested it, he tried it, and we can read about his life and how he overcame, and it'll work for us in the same fashion.
Yes,
so we're finna get a prayer, and we're finna get involved with this. And get your Bibles, your notepads, pencils, iPads, whatever you're going on, we're finna get into this word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, right now, in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our strength, our Redeemer.
Yes,
Father, we thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for redeeming us from the curse of the law.
Yes.
Thank you for reversing the curse.
Thank you, Lord.
With redemption through the blood of Jesus. Father God, we want to thank you for destroying our sin nature.
Yes.
We want to thank you for giving us your Holy Spirit. You promised Abraham that all the families of the earth will be blessed through faithful Abraham. And the promise was the Holy Spirit that you promised us, and we now have that.
Yes.
And we thank you for you being faithful and not being a man that you should lie and speak and you not do what you said you was going to do. Father God, we need you tonight.
Yes.
We need your Holy Spirit. We need your wisdom. And we humble ourselves and come under the anointing that you have tailored for us tonight. And we thank you for your power
thank
and your
you,
presence.
Lord,
and we put a demand on your power and presence that it may bring clarity and understanding to the individuals who hear it, and that it may increase the faith of some where they just know it's God's word and it's right for them to hold on to and put it in their arsenal. Father God, we thank you now.
Thank you, Lord.
We trust your leading and your prompting.
Yes, God.
Thank you right now. We receive this anointing that you have for us tonight by faith in Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, Bishop. We're going to read Ephesians 6, and we're going to start with 10, and let's see, 12. Can you, let's do 13. We'll stop there.
Okay.
Okay, 10 through 13.
Ephesians chapter 6, starting at verse number 10. I'm reading from the Amplified. In conclusion, be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with him.
Mm-hmm.
Draw your strength from him, that strength which his boundless might provides.
Hallelujah.
Put on God's whole armor,
mm-hmm.
the armor of a heavy armed soldier which God supplies, that you may be able successfully to stand up against all the strategies and the deceits of the devil.
All right.
For we wrestle For we are not wrestling with flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents, but against the dispositum, against the powers, against the master spirit who are the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spirit forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural sphere. Therefore, put on God's complete armor, that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the evil day of danger, and having done all the crisis demand, to stand firmly in your place.
Stop right there, Bishop. This is beautiful, and I like how God is giving the believers instructions on how to be successful in combat.
Right.
And we got to learn how to follow instruction. It says master spirits. Okay. It talks about, it says, therefore put on God's complete armor that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the day of evil, of danger, and having done all the crisis demand.
Right.
To stand firmly in your place. Have we done all to stand?
No.
Okay, if there is a lack of obedience, then we have not done all to stand. Now, we might can look at this and say, well, it working for some, why don't it work for me? Well, did you really mean Romans 10 and 9 when you confessed it? Mm. Were you genuine in your confession, whether it was in your car, at a gas station, in the sanctuary, at the house of God, or at work, or wherever you confessed that? Was it genuine?
Okay.
So after Romans, we're going to go flip over here to Romans 10 and 9. And we're going to talk, we're going to start from there, because if we get this right, first step, we can't play baseball with basketball rules.
Right.
And the church need to learn God's way of doing things and not try to live in the world and be godly by playing, using the ways of the world and trying to be godly. It's not going to work. Okay.
Romans chapter 10, verse 9 from the Amplified. Because if you acknowledge and confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and in your heart believe, adhere to, trust in, and rely on the truth that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The King James says, you shall be saved.
Okay.
Verse 10 says, for with the heart a person believes.
Okay.
Adheres to, trust in, and relies on Christ, and so is justified, declared righteous, acceptable to God, and with the mouth he confesses, declares openly, and speak out freely his faith, and confirms his salvation.
Okay. So, Bishop, what right here in verse 9? If you acknowledge and confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and in your heart believe and adhere to, trust in, and to rely on the truth that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
Okay.
Okay, let's talk about that. Many have done that. Many have made that confession.
Amen.
I have led them through that confession so many times.
Okay.
And to only see, out of my 30-some years, that people not holding to their confession.
Okay.
They waver, and I understand there's going to be some wavering, but sooner or later, there's a falling away. Okay. And I'm calling, trying to find out. Some of them didn't answer their phone, and I never saw them again.
Okay.
And I hope that individual really don't think salvation transpired in their life because they made a confession.
Okay.
And if you don't follow up on your confession or acknowledge what you're doing, what can we say to the audience tonight to help bring clarity about what true salvation is?
I think one of the things we got to look at when you really look at Romans 10 and 9 and you look at the word believe, in my estimation, is another word that constitutes a covenant agreement. Your confession, you're not confessing to some man or some woman. You're confessing to the Word of God.
Okay, that's
true. So now, when you confess to the Word of God, it's like you're giving a response with your confession, because it says, if you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart. So I think the word heart is what throws people, because they're looking, if I believe it here.
Mm-hmm.
The word heart and mind interchanges.
Right.
It works synonymous one with the other.
Right.
So belief starts in the mind, then it trickles to the heart. Because what I'm learning is when the mind is believing God and the heart confess, now God hears something.
Okay.
So when God hears something, it's just like God, when God hear us say something to him, it's just like when he says something to us. When God says something to us, he wants a response. When we say something to God, we want him to respond.
Right.
So he accepts us then. So now what God does, he saves us from death to life.
Okay.
From a life of sin to a life of righteousness.
Say that, from a life of sin. A life of sin, not to confess Christ and to go back into a sinful lifestyle.
Right.
Okay.
Let me say this here. Notice I didn't say sins with an S.
Right.
I said sin.
Right.
So he saved us from a life of disobedience
to a
life of obedience.
Hallelujah. Amen.
See, the thing we got to realize is God saved us from this life of sin to a life of righteousness. Everything else that comes after, if we remain in sin, are symptoms of sin.
Amen.
The root cause of sin is disobedience.
Amen.
Go ahead, Apostle.
So with what you just said was, if we understand through salvation, Christ destroyed through the death, burial, and resurrection, destroyed our sin nature.
Uh-huh.
And deposited something within us that will cause us, if we stay with our confession, will cause us to grow.
Okay.
Will cause us to grow as children of God. And there's a grace there to help us walk out an obedient life.
Right.
God is not calling us to something that he did not equip us.
Okay.
To do. And so many got this mindset. Well, I heard this, but God knows we're not perfect. Ain't nobody perfect. Well, the Greek word for perfect means mature.
Mature.
God is requiring us to grow up and mature. So, yes, it is capable for us to outgrow some things. Because if you walk with God and stay with the confession that you made, let's throw baptism. After you confess, baptism is a sign to show the church, I'm denouncing the world. I made a confession, and now I want to be baptized to show I'm a part of this local body of believers. So I'm coming in to be baptized and to show what's in my heart. You can't see what's in me, but I'm going to go ahead and get baptized to show you that I want to become a part of you. Now I'm baptized.
Okay.
Now I'm in. I need spiritual parents.
Okay.
Let's, just like a baby, you've been born again. I don't care if you're 50. I don't care if you're 30. You could be 19. And your 19 years of living can't help you right now. The baby has to rely on the parents to help nurture, protect. And I think the parishioners need to learn to trust their women and men of God, if God led you there, then you need to trust your spiritual leaders. The spiritual parents to help nurse you and grow you and to protect you.
Amen.
Go ahead.
And I think one of the things, I'm going to add this for a more excellent way. God didn't just rescue us. He saved us.
He saved us. Amen. Okay?
And then when you went on to say being baptized, a lot of us were baptized as children and we didn't understand.
True.
We had no knowledge. We only did it because our parents want us to go through. But as I grew older and I began to study and seek out baptism, now I can identify with what Christ did for me.
Amen. Romans.
What Christ did was he delivered, he saved me, he rescued and saved me from that old life of sin. I was born into sin and shaping in iniquity. Put me back in right standing with the Father.
Amen.
And so I can identify now with the death, burial, and the resurrection, not just the death and the burial.
We finna celebrate.
But the getting up.
Amen. We finna celebrate Resurrection Day.
Right.
And a lot of people do not understand what the resurrection means.
They really don't. So we must understand that when he got up, he gave me new life.
Hallelujah. And we should also walk in newness of life.
In the newness of
we
life.
We cannot go back because he destroyed your sin nature.
Right.
He made sure that we are capable of not yielding our members to unrighteousness anymore. We are yielding our members, our hands, our eyes, our feet to righteousness. Because he put something in us to cause us
right.
to desire righteousness.
Right.
So
right.
we can't say we have a desire to do wrong. We cannot lean to our own understanding and say, well, I'm saved anyhow. So Bishop, okay, so we did the Romans 10 and 9.
Okay.
We done got baptized.
Okay.
Okay. Now, is that going to stop the enemy from messing with the individual who just confessed Christ?
No.
Okay.
Because verse number 10, if I may go there, for with the heart, for with the mind, a person believes, adheres to,
trust
in, and relies on Christ. So it is in my mind. If I can begin to renew my mind and I can talk to myself that I'm adhering to what I just confessed, I'm trusting in what I confessed, I'm relying on Christ for what I just confessed.
Okay, now, and what you just said is wonderful because I just got through doing some teaching on is too many believers depending on themselves and what they're doing instead of what God did for them through Jesus Christ.
Okay.
My faith is in the risen Savior. My faith is in the death, burial, the resurrection, the blood that was shed, the stripes that he took. My works cannot outdo what Jesus did. And
right.
when you said be strong in the Lord, in the strength that he provides.
Right.
Man, that Bishop, that's where I camp out in.
Okay.
That's where I live, move, and have my being. And Philippians 2 and 13, Paul said, I'm ready for anything, equal to anything.
Okay.
Through Christ who infuses inner strength within me. So these are the benefits that a believer gets, but the average individual, well, I'm saved, and like you said something. So many got baptized, and the parents said, it's time for you to get baptized.
Yeah.
And there was no confession.
There was no confession.
What I do here, when I get ready to baptize, the last young lady we baptized in the new year, this new year, I set her down and taught her what baptism was.
Okay.
She said she understood, but I kept repeating. I kept repeating, and I looked on her face. I said, you're a smart young lady. Don't get offended, but you've never known this spiritually. So I need for you to glean this spiritually. Don't hear what your physical ear, because I'm talking spirit. This is what baptism is. And she understood because she's real sharp in the natural thing.
Okay.
And she think that's going to suffice in the spirit. And she found out it's not going to cut it. So she understood baptism, and I took her, and we baptized her.
Okay.
You know, so I want to make sure that I explain to everyone who comes up and confess Christ of what baptism is and what they done got themselves into.
Okay.
Do you really know what you have got yourself into? You made a statement earlier, Bishop, about the covenant, the contract.
Uh-huh.
When we go to the bank or to the car dealer and we done got picked out what we want and we signed the contract.
Okay.
And then if we go against any one of those stipulations of calls, phone calls to start coming, of repossession, we'll feel like the people are mistreating you.
Right.
But you agreed to the terms
right.
and the stipulations of the contract.
Right.
So it is with God. You made a covenant with God.
Amen.
Okay. So help us there. Give us some insight now that we're saved and we should find out and ask questions. And like you ask questions, I ask questions after Bible class, after service. You didn't understand something I said, call me.
Right.
I want to make sure you get the right understanding before Satan snatches it.
I think a lot of people in the body of Christ and our viewing and listening audience, I think if you have went through Romans 10:9 and for some reason you keep gravitating back to the old life or the old nature, I think it is befitting for you to go to your leader and says, I need to understand this fully.
Okay.
Because every day that there's breath in your body, you have a chance to get this right. And I believe that there are people that God has strategically put in place that has been qualified to teach this in a manner that even a child could understand it.
Amen, Bishop.
Because I feel like that God wants everybody to know the penalty of the contract before you confess it.
Okay, amen.
Because, I mean, it's just like a natural contract. If you break it, the contract is legal and binding except one party reneges.
Okay.
So we act like God is any different. When we do Romans 10:9, God is holding us accountable.
He's holding us accountable.
So if you don't understand, wisdom is the principal thing, but in all thy getting, we need to get and understand it. And it's nothing to be ashamed of if you don't understand what you did.
That's right.
I believe God would rather for you to admit I did it in error or in ignorance, but now I want to know.
Amen, Bishop. You said something right there. Because most people are ashamed because they don't know.
Right.
And they're not going to ask questions. And I tell them, don't be ashamed because I didn't know.
Right.
I didn't know. When I first got saved, they had to use the table of content.
Okay.
And I tell people, do not be ashamed, but it should be pew ministers that be sitting by somebody who don't know. Show them.
Show them how to get there.
And don't be afraid, because when I got saved, I started asking questions. I wanted to know. I'm like, I'm saved. I'm excited. What about this? What about that? I was getting on folk nerves. And then finally, they started ignoring me. So I just went home and started studying.
Yeah.
I went home and started praying and asking God. So, Bishop, right here. I'm over in Romans 6.
Okay.
Okay. Now, we are buried, 6:4. Well, I read one. I got to get that.
Okay.
Okay, because that baptism was a watery grave.
Okay.
What shall we say to all this? This is Amplified. Okay. Are we to remain in sin in order that God's grace, favor, and mercy may multiply and overflow?
Mm.
Verse 2, certainly not. Okay? How can we who have died to sin live any longer therein? Baptism is a replica of what happened to Jesus.
Okay.
He was put in a grave.
Uh-huh.
And on the third day, the Father raised him up. So we lay you down in that watery grave, and when we bring you up, you have been resurrected in newness of life.
Okay.
Okay. It says here, verse 4. Now, 3. Are you ignorant of the fact that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?
Okay.
Okay. Now, we were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, so we too might habitually live and behave in newness of life.
Wow.
So, Bishop, that's where we got to start living now, in the new. The renewal, the renewing of the mind.
Okay.
We got to put ourselves in another arena. Abram had never heard God's voice before. Abram. Get out of your father's house. Leave your country.
And your kindred.
And your kinfolk. They were moon worshipers. God couldn't have got what he needed to get to Abraham if he had stayed in the midst of all that
paganism.
And so it is with us. If you make a valid confession and you were serious, you got to come out from among them.
Right.
It's going to hinder your walk. It's going to slow you down. It's going to rob you of your confession. You'll do yourself well to find you some spiritual people who can take you or hang with your parents or whoever. You need to be around somebody who can help you grow spiritually.
Amen. If you go back up to that first verse, Apostle,
okay.
See, that word sin doesn't have an S.
It don't.
So shall we continue? What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin? Shall we continue to be disobedient to the word of God?
Okay, now, you setting us up for Ephesians 6 and 10. The armor of God is the word of God.
It's the word
How
of God.
Can I be disobedient to the very thing that's going to protect me in the time of battle? Jesus was obedient to the word, and he had confidence in saying it is written. But the average person who is not, don't believe that I'm saved and Jesus paid for all my sins, I can go back to live the way I was living and bear no consequences. Saints, if you one of those people that think like that, I beg you not to adopt that mindset. That's not going to do you any good. Bishop, right here, okay, it says in verse 6, we know that our old unrenewed self was nailed to the cross with him in order that our body, which is the instrument of sin, might be made ineffective and inactive for evil. That's how God did it.
Okay. Let me. Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
My translation said it is rendered inoperable.
In layman's terms.
Our old nature has been rendered. In other words, it don't exist. It has been nullified.
Okay, Bishop. I believe that because the word of God said it. It's the truth. Uh-huh. All right, now, what if an individual said, but I still want to sin. I still have this desire.
You can't identify with him according to verse 3. You weren't baptized with him in his death. So that means you're choosing to keep your old sin nature.
Wow.
It's operative. It's not inoperative. It is operative. In other words, it has the capacity now to continue to operate.
Oh, I agree. So can we trust the Holy Scriptures, all Scriptures of God breathed, that my sin nature is inactive, inoperative, it's been destroyed? Okay. Hallelujah. I need to get in on that and confess that, get it into my spirit, renew my mind with it, so when these things come up, you inoperative. I'm not dealing with you.
Right.
You need to put it down, just like a rabid dog, you got to put it down. Put it down, because if you don't, you'll think like, wait a minute, I'm saved. But why am I still having these desires?
Yeah.
Okay?
I think what the believers got to do is to talk to themselves when this is inoperative.
Okay. All right.
Somewhere we got to get it.
We do, Bishop. So right here, it also says, for when a man dies, he is freed, loosened, delivered from the power of sin among men.
Uh-huh.
Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we should also live with him.
Okay.
Because we know that Christ, the anointed one, being once raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has power over him.
Okay.
Verse 10, for by the death he died. He died to sin, ending his relationship to it once and for all.
Uh-huh.
So if I still want to stay in relationship with sin, how can I be in a right standing relationship with God?
You can't. It's impossible.
It's impossible to do so. Okay, so it says in relation to it once and for all, and the life that he lives, he is living to God in unbroken fellowship with him. So, verse 11 in Romans 6 said, even so, consider yourself also dead to sin, and your relationship to it is broken, but alive to God, living in unbroken fellowship with him in Christ Jesus.
Wow.
So, God fixed, he reversed the curse of what Adam, restored the unbroken fellowship to where we now can fellowship through Jesus Christ, death, burial, and resurrection. I have an advocate with the Father. I have access to God through Christ.
Yes.
Through obedience.
Uh-huh. Everything. I think one of the things that we got to focus in on is everything that the Scripture talks about has to be done in obedience.
I'm blessed by what you said, and that's true. We got to understand that God requires obedience from
he
us.
Requires.
He requires. This is how God knows that we love you. If you love me, keep my commandments.
Yeah.
That's the first, well, love. The love of God has been shedded abroad in our hearts at conversion too by the Holy Ghost.
Uh-huh.
So God is love. Love is spirit. And if God put it there through the Holy Spirit, now when I got born again, God activated that love in me for him.
Right.
So now I need to make a decision to go after what I now love. But that sin nature is destroyed to keep me from going back to the old and where now I got something in me that's craving like a baby craves milk.
Right. We gotta trust, adhere to, and have confidence in Christ and believe that our sin nature has been destroyed.
Bishop, one of your favorite verses, and I got the scripture backwards. Numbers 19:23 or 23:19.
23:19.
God is not a human. One translation says God is not human that he should lie.
Right.
He is not a man. So if he said it, won't he do it?
He'll do it.
So how many people have confidence that God cannot lie?
I think that's kind of wavery in the believer because they think this is just words on the page. This is God breathed. God's word is God. God is his word. That's his bond.
Okay. So I believe Romans 10:9 to the I'm going to heaven. Despite of my lifestyle and my behavior, I'm saved.
Okay.
But that believer that I'm just describing, there is no fruit to depict that the love, Romans 5:5, was shedded abroad in his heart. Okay, from love come joy, peace, gentleness, meekness, temperance. These things make up the characteristics of God. Then Romans, 1 Corinthians 13. So I can have the tongues of men and of angels.
Right.
And
right.
Have not, now we're going to use charity. We want to say what it is, love. I am becoming as a tinkling cymbal and a sounding brass. We making a lot of noise because if the love and the evidence of that's not there, how can Christ-like features and us being Christian, because Christian means Christ-like.
That's what it means. And so if you're disobedient, you're not a Christian.
Now, I agree with that, and because based on where I come from and when I got saved, Bishop, I have seen people start off on fire.
Did I say that right?
Yeah, you said it right.
Okay.
You said it right. It's so much coming at me because, Bishop, I done seen people start off on fire. Oh, I'm ahead of you, and they making it out to be a competition. This is a sprint. This ain't no sprint. It's a marathon. So I look up and saw a lot of people I started with. Nowhere to be found. They ended up, something happened. But I had the same opportunity to fall by the wayside. The race is not given to the swift, nor the battle to the strong.
Right. But he that endures to the end.
Okay. So, we got to, if we're going to confess Christ, saints of God, if you in a church that's teaching the word of God, and the man and woman of God loves you and watching over your soul to make sure that you grow and get the proper nutrients to grow, then you got to allow that man and woman of God access
right.
to you. And see, so many do the themselves an injustice by not trusting, sitting under somebody whom they don't respect and call them my pastor or my apostle or bishop and pastor or whatever and have no respect for them.
Wow.
It's not going to do you any good.
It's not gonna do any good.
On top of this, saints, you can't eat off everybody's table. If you was birthed in the ministry, stay with that team, that mother and father spiritually, the ones who God assigned to feed you. And if you eating off all these different tables, you're going to get confused.
And, you know, I think a lot of times, Apostle, in the body of Christ, there is a time that you can come to a level of maturity, not mature knowing everything.
Right.
That God will place you somewhere else, but Your leader will get an unction from the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
That it is your time.
Amen.
And nobody is trying to control anybody in the body of Christ. Leaders got your best interests at heart if they are from God.
If they are from God.
If they are called by God and has been qualified and justified and sanctified, they have your best interests at heart. It might seem hard sometimes, but we got to learn how to take the hard truth of the Word of God.
That's true, because there's nothing easy about this walk with God. It's not easy, but it's doable.
It's doable.
Jesus is not asking us to do something he knows we cannot do. Now, one of the things that I find, Bishop, with believers who have grown some, they try to see from a parishioner's viewpoint into a man or woman of God viewpoint. And you have no access to that. You don't have the insight to see what God is doing with his man. The children of Israel got in trouble trying to do that with Moses.
Yeah.
They don't, you're not called to see. A parishioner cannot see what the man of God is seeing. God didn't open that up to you. And now you may grow and get some knowledge, but by the time you get there and trust it, God will be done elevated the man. You know, he's constantly bringing a man that's in the Word and have yielded himself to God, but it's a competition in this, and God is not in this competition. Everybody's not growing at the same pace. I didn't grow at the same pace. But when I finally caught it, when I did get the Spirit, things were easy because the Holy Spirit would talk. He would share with me what to hear and what not to take in.
Right.
I would be sitting in the service and he said, don't receive all of that.
Wow.
I'm serious. And they would get mad, like, who you think you are? I'm teaching you. Yes, you are, but I go home and read.
Yeah, yeah. And I think a lot of time, too, people got to understand when God elevates the leader, God elevates the leader to leadership status. He elevates the parishioners to parishioner status.
Right.
And God has a way of differentiating who's going to get what. And one thing that I'm learning about God gives to whom he pleases. He elevates whom he pleases.
Whom he pleases.
So, you know, it shouldn't be a competitive thing. It should be, they should pray that God will elevate their leaders to another dimension of his faith so that they can rise up.
Bishop, the most of our, I hate to use our because God don't see color, but most in the churches today is competition. They're trying to show I know more than the man and woman of God. And you're going to find yourself getting in trouble doing that. That's not what they're for. I need people who want to know and learn to use your knowledge. Everybody in the body of Christ is important.
Everybody.
You have a major role to help the body of this ministry become successful.
Apostle, let me say something real quick. A lot of times, I've had people to tell me that, well, I know more than you. I said, but do you know how to lead?
Okay.
See, you can know more than me, but do you have the qualifications that is required to lead God's people in the direction that God has taken them?
And see, most of them make that statement, Bishop, what I have learned in my lifetime, they just looking at because they know a lot of scriptures. And no, they don't know how to lead. They're not looking at it from that standpoint. They're looking at the fact that they think they got something that you don't have.
Wow.
And they don't know how to lead. No, they don't. They don't.
Wow.
And I've seen that. And so, if Bishop, when I met you, I looked at what you were doing and how you teach, okay? I didn't get intimidated. I said, that's a brother I can latch on to, and we can become better with both of us than somebody getting jealous of one another.
Right. Same
but
thing here.
I understand. I done played team sports. It took the whole team. One person didn't win for the whole team. It took all the team. It took the coach calling somebody to pinch run, calling a pinch hitter, taking this person out, putting that person in. He was utilizing everybody in. But if we don't learn that everybody is important, when your number is called, be ready to add.
Amen.
But it's not about I'm more anointed. It's the whole body of Christ is anointed. But if there is no obedience, then there's no anointing.
Right. Even in the anointing, there's an order.
Wow. Okay. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus flowed with what was in order.
He said,
I only say what I hear my Father say. I only do what I see what my Father showed me to do. And the Holy Spirit told him, and he did not move out of that order.
Right.
What is Jesus trying to show us here? So if we take what Romans 10 and 9 says, and we understand Romans 6 about our sin nature, and we don't yield our members to sin anymore, to unrighteousness, but righteousness, and start practicing these things, then we'll find ourselves growing and get with other believers who are growing and build some camaraderie. But most believers, Bishop, I see, want to be isolated. They want to be off to themselves, saying, God got me over here. I'm so anointed. And I'm sorry, a foot cannot grow detached from the body.
It can't.
An eye cannot see out of the eye socket.
It can't. I think if the believers ever get the revelation that what God has anointed you for in its perspective place, the body of Christ will become fitly joined together.
Okay. Now, you said earlier, if there is no obedience, there is no salvation. I made a confession. I am a CEO Christian. Christmas and Easter only. Is that salvation?
It says it's an everyday thing.
It's every day. At home, you wake up in the morning. You know you're in the presence of God. Good morning, Heavenly Father. And I begin my day with thanking him and making my confession of I'm rededicating myself for ministry and whatever your will is for me today, I'm here at your disposal. Instruct me, order my steps. Then I begin to speak over the church and their daily routine and their work day and the marriages. And God may put somebody in my spirit that may be struggling. I don't know what the struggle is, but if they come up, and then I begin to thank God, and as he put the prayer in my spirit, I pray as I'm led to pray. I'm Amen. Not coming up with nothing on my own because I don't know how to pray.
Amen.
So, okay. So with that, if there is no obedience in Romans 10, I'm not obeying with the confession, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So now I got to put some feet to my confession.
Right.
I've got to now come to word study, Sunday school, Bible class, and any other special classes that is going on to give myself a fair chance to grow in spiritual things.
Amen. And I think, Apostle, one of the things people got to understand is when you first come to Christ and you're trying to learn how to establish a relationship with God, there are going to be some things that you're going to have to neglect in order to get to know your confession. You're going to have to spend time in word study. You're going to have to spend time in Sunday school.
Right.
You're going to have to spend time in prayer. These are things that is going to build you in your relationship
right.
with God.
Right.
These relationships just don't happen because
it don't.
Say I'm saved.
It don't. And it's not an overnight thing.
It's
and so many people think that because the Spirit, I grow overnight. No. It's just like a newborn baby.
Amen.
The process is there.
Amen.
You may be 30, 50, or 80 getting saved, and you can't take them 80, 50, 30 years into your Christianity, because if you got born today and you 75, you're a baby spiritually.
You might as well go and say it to them. You got to unlearn 75 years of doing it your way, because once you accept Christ as Lord and Savior, not just as Lord and Savior. Now you're no longer your own.
You've been bought with a price.
You've been bought with a price.
Now, therefore, you got to trust, rely on, and depend on the teaching of God to get you. Like you said, you got to unlearn. Most people don't want to unlearn what grandmama taught them or mm-hmm. what somebody taught them, and they holding on to it, and they think it's scripture. But when they do, if they ever go and look in the book and find the scripture, they'll find out this stuff is misquoted and is not in sequence with the flow
Amen.
Of what God is saying.
Amen.
And then it's hurtful because they're going to realize I've been lied to all this time. But that's okay. Now you got a chance to know the truth. You will know the truth, and the truth is going to make you free. So, Bishop, what you said, are you willing to unlearn what you have learned? Are you willing to unlearn to be learned? Because I have had people come in off the street and like, I know more than you. I want to debate you. I don't debate the Bible.
I don't debate it.
I'm like Paul. Paul said, avoid foolish and unlearned quick.
Right.
Sometimes they come in and I recognize the spirit. How they come in and try to, and see, that is not what this is for.
Right.
And see, so many Christians want to say, oh, they know the Bible. Okay, that's good. But can you live
Amen.
The scriptures? So what? I preached a sermon one time. So what if you go to heaven knowing more scriptures than me? Mm. Can you live the scriptures you know?
Right.
Because every verse that has the man or woman of God has took the hard stuff away from around it that you struggle with, and they gave it to you after they done took the hard stuff, and you don't apply that, you're held accountable for that scripture.
Amen.
Everything that you know concerning the word of God and you're not doing, you held accountable. Bishop, five wise and five foolish.
Uh-huh.
Okay, they was all virgins. Five wise took oil in their vessels and they took more oil.
Excess.
They took excess. But the foolish took lamps with oil and took no excess.
No excess.
And they said, give us something. No, go buy for yourself.
Uh-huh.
But when they left,
he showed up
and they went in and he closed the door.
Yep.
But they didn't do what the wise did.
No, they didn't.
So if you're wise and your confession was genuine, you'll do yourself a great deal of good by obeying your confession.
Amen. Amen.
Learning to be obedient to the teaching that you're now finna get. You got to start obeying. The love of God is in you. Now you're going to have to forgive. You can't retaliate. You
right.
can't hold grudges.
Right.
God, that was
right.
the first. And I can be a witness to that. God got on me. Oh, Lord, did he chastise me about I've forgiven you. You got to learn how to forgive. And Bishop, it kept happening. And it kept happening. I kept flunking. To finally, God kept on, and man, it got to the point to where God wasn't finna let me go no further until I forgave every offense that happened to me.
My God.
And I'm so glad that he worked that mess out of me. He kept letting it happen. I developed an unforgiveness because I had to work that love muscle. I had to forgive.
Wow.
I had to forgive. I was in the weight room. I was in the gym working out because offense after offense after offense. After offense until it humbled me.
Wow.
God said, I don't want to hear it. I'm responding to you because of how you responded. You should have acted in love. No matter what anybody do to you, your response should always be in love.
If you confess in him.
If I'm confessing him. Because Jesus said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do.
They do.
So we wanted to go there. If you genuinely saved and you are walking in obedience, When the warfare comes, you can stand in the evil days. You'll be able to do warfare because you're trusting and relying on the scriptures that you confess with a Romans 10 and 9.
Right.
I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. So the gospel is going to help create and strengthen you in the day. And you're going to have to trust the word like Jesus did. We all are going to have to find our strength in the word of God.
In the word of God.
In the word of God. Not twisting it, not turning it, not making it fit me, but reading it like it is.
Amen.
And accepting it. This is the written word of God, so I got to take it just like he said it. And then you're going to run into people saying, well, you know that ain't what he really meant. I done heard that. Well, what did he mean? He meant exactly what he said.
Exactly what he said.
He meant exactly what he said. So, Bishop, we got 5 minutes here. So, with that being said, if we learn to obey, you'll find out the word of God will work for you. And you ain't got to worry about God allowing you to go into battle into something he know you can't have. That's one thing I love about God. And he always leave a way of escape. Always. So we need to trust in our risen Savior and in the Holy Scriptures that he has given us. Every scripture is God-breathed, given for the inspiration. And Bishop, I've made my mind up to preach the truth. I don't care how unpopular it becomes and have become.
Amen.
I'm not trying to get a great following because Jesus said, remember, the world hated me first.
Right.
If you're going to do the truth, if you're going to stand with the truth, for those who will live godly will be persecuted.
They're going to suffer. The scripture said, Apostle, can I fast forward to Ephesians?
Yes, sir.
There was something in Ephesians. In conclusion, be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with him. Draw your strength from him. In other words, what Christ is saying to us, don't try to do it in your victory. Do it from my victory.
That's what I was alluding to. I'm working out my salvation. I got faith and confidence in what I'm doing. You just gave us the answer. Wow, a lot of believers are failing because they're doing it and believing in their strength. If right. Christ is not your strength, you're going to end up falling.
You're going to fall.
But what you just said, we have to depend on what he has done on our behalf and what he's offering us to
Amen.
Help us to stand in the evil day.
Amen.
And saints, if you do that, what the man of God just said, you'll find yourself overcoming. You'll find yourself having victories. And then Christianity is going to become fun then, because now you're learning how to walk above where you thought it wasn't possible by listening to people all have
wow.
sinned and come short of the glory of God. No, so all can live right and all can be obedient if we so desire.
Amen.
God said he'll give us
Amen.
The desires of our heart.
Amen.
But that ain't just houses, land, and cars. If I want to please God, and that's your desire, he'll give you the desires to please him.
Amen.
Amen. Well, that's our time. But look, read Ephesians 6 and 10 and go over that because we're going there.
Amen.
And 2 Corinthians 10 and 5. The weapons of our warfare are not M16, bazookas, and nitroglycerin, and all that stuff. No. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down. See, when you become mature, you can learn how to pull stuff down.
Yep.
You don't let these thoughts just ride.
Right.
Amen? But that's our time. We pray and trust that something was said to get you to thinking about was your confession genuine. And if it is, give God praise. If it ain't, get on your knees and confess and find yourself in a church, because churches are opening back up. If your church ain't open, I'm not telling you to leave your ministry, but you need hands on. You need hands on. You need to be calling your man and woman of God and ask, is there any way we can do something here? Something got to be done, because the baby, we can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. And we can't give birth to a child and leave it on somebody's doorstep.
Right.
So this is our time. Bishop Larry Donald from Greater Trinity. We thank God for this brother.
Bless you.
And we are here at Kingdom Faith. I'm Apostle Clifford Daniels, Sr. Until next time, be blessed in the Lord and in the power of his might.
Yes.
Put on the whole armor of God, and you will be able to stand in Jesus' name. Amen.